Hey folks, Chris Garlock back with Michael Redmond. We're into the second half, game 31, heading for 60. These are the really interesting games that Master played with a succession of top players. And Michael, I think we have a new player today. Is that correct?
Yes. He only played this one game. It's Lee Jingzhong. At the time, he was a nine don, but he was not yet a world champion. I think he became a world champion in the Asian TV Cup in 2017. So he was on his way there. And it was interesting because he's one of the players who was pretty tight. He played the knights, corner enclosures, and stuff like that. And he liked territory in the opening, but he changed shortly after this game. So I saw his game records changing the way he played. To the big shimaris and modern openings shortly after he played this game. So I think AlphaGo had a pretty immediate effect on him. It had an immediate effect on a lot of players, but I think he was one of the players who quickly changed.
Well, and I want to say that that's one of the things that's been, we had done a number of commentaries at the time of these games, not as many obviously as we're doing now, but what's sort of interesting going back and seeing so many of them in a relatively short period of time, seeing so many different players, and then also now, this is a few years later, and we have the opportunity to see what's happened with some of those players. And as you were just saying, it's even these master games, I'm not sure are fully appreciated for the impact that they've had on the world of Go.
Yes. I think master had the biggest impact because it was intuitively easy to understand what Master was doing. So this version of AlphaGo, it's much more difficult to sort of decipher what's going on in the AlphaGo Zero games, for instance. even though they're calling it AlphaGo Master, the later games that came out a few months after this, in which Master was playing itself, they also seem to be different and more difficult to understand.
Right.
That's the other series we're doing at the AGA YouTube channel.
Yeah, those are very complex games. But these games, of course, this is largely due to your terrific analysis. But they because they're human players, they're playing things that we know. They're reacting emotionally. Frankly, we're seeing that sometime. Well, we saw that in the last game where he was just like, "Well, you're not going to push me around."
Got into hot water, right?
Very hot water. The knives came out.
Yeah.
All right, let's take a look.
Okay, we're going to see AlphaGo's favorite opening again. AlphaGo has black, and it plays the large shimari. So this is the way AlphaGo plays when white has played a 3-4 point in the lower left corner. And white plays here. So we've talked about this before.
Yeah.
And actually, white could even start with this move. Maybe I didn't say this before. We've seen white playing the kakari. And then I was saying maybe white should continue with this.
Right.
Actually, it gets a pretty good score to start with this move too. And sometimes it's hard to tell which is best. It's sometimes the programs seem to go back and forth depending on how many searches you've done and how many and how it turns out that particular time. But this move is just—it's a move splitting the side like this is a move that humans almost automatically played before AlphaGo and before using computer programs. And pretty much universally, this move is not liked by computer programs. It gives white a slight disadvantage.
There's a word in Japanese. I remember when I was studying Japanese Go terms, and there's a word, and you'll know it, lukewarm.
Nurui.
Yeah. That's
the translation of that word.
Yeah, but and it's a similar sort of a feeling. Like it's just sort of a kind of a move, and that's what I've always sort of instinctively felt about that splitting move is that people like it because it kind of just splits it up before the other person gets there, but it's not really an active move, is it?
Well put. Of course, there is the idea that since it's the right side is an area where black already has three stones, we thought that white had to have a defensive posture here, so white was making interchangeable points of these two points. So there is a proverb that says when you split the side, you want to have room to make two space extensions in either side.
Mm.
And so it was just the way we played it at the time. But, you know, the programs prefer moves like this, for instance. Or actually, in this series, AlphaGo is playing, usually is playing the high shimari, I think. Although in one of the games, we did see white playing a low shimari. That was the game against Miyu Ting a few games ago. So black plays the kakari, and white plays here. Again, we find that the computer programs will give you a bad score if you play this pincer, because black gets to press here. So people would, I would play this way maybe. This is the one variation that I sort of like for white, and something like this could follow. Otherwise, moves like this or this, these would be perfectly okay. It's just that I sort of like to finish off the lower side with this variation.
And this is something that we've talked about in this recent series, because they just keep pincering. And I know we've mentioned it, but I just am a little, because these took place, you know, it's not like they were weeks apart. These were happening within a few days. And it,
in a few days. People, in a way, it would be difficult for people to prepare. There's also the fact that this was a very common opening at the time. And the way that humans were playing was a way that was supposed to be working. They didn't know it was bad. And they didn't have a computer program to tell them that it was bad at the time. Most of the games that we've seen so far had white starting with an approach move at the mark point. So it's, this is a bit different in this case, AlphaGo was actually going to play the knight's move. Whereas in those other games where white had played the marked exchange here, we were seeing AlphaGo playing the large knight's move. And I did talk about some of my theories about why that was happening. But I'm not, I shouldn't call them theories. They're just hypotheses. And so black presses here. And actually, this is a point where black could have played the other way. I would have been, had a hard time choosing between this move and this move. They both seem to be reasonably good. But in this board position, I think every time AlphaGo is choosing this one. This is where in the game white kicks here. And white's going to get into a lot of trouble here already. Like this is where white gets into trouble. So after this move, black has something like 59% or 10 points before Komi. And it would have been better for white to play here and just avoid being attacked on the left side of the board. So black gets to play on the outside, maybe like this, the upper side. But this would be relatively good. It's still already a difficult. If you ask a computer program like Qincheng, the moment black gets to press here in the lower left corner, black's score is going to go up. So it's already a good score for black, but this would have been better than the game, at least. And this is a position where if I were playing, I would not see anything wrong with what white is doing here. White's playing, seems to be playing fairly steadily. So it's just the evaluation of this position in the lower left corner, which computer programs are saying is good for black. And we didn't really realize that at the time. In the game, white answers in the corner. Obviously, this is grabbing that corner territory for the time being. It's an active way to play, heading towards the upper side. So white's trying to take a territorial advantage. And white will deal with this group. So like if black plays something like this, the idea is that white can just run out like this. And black's wall in the lower left, maybe that's not so strong either. So if white can get something close to an equal fight in the center of the board, then white's territories in these two corners will make up for black's potential territories in these two corners, and the territory is sort of balanced. So this was white's game plan, you might say. But when AlphaGo plays here, this is putting white under a lot of pressure. White pushes, and black plays a hane. And the idea is that if white curls around here, black will be able to close off the center. And with a computer program, closing off the center is always given a lot of extra. It's compared to the human analysis, closing off the center seems to give some extra points to Black. It gives gives Black a good score. So this is, at the time I thought maybe White should have done this, but it turns out that's not going to be a very good score either. In the game, White moves out. But I really like this sequence for Black, where Black has played the key point here, a hane on top of the two white stones. And then covering here, Black is getting a nice little area here. So the Black group is relatively strong, while White's group is eyeless. So Black has accomplished that. It turns out White's next mistake here is going to be here, where White played Antari. This was actually, I would say this is a vulgar move. And it's not a move that...
I was itching to play it. It seemed so obvious to me. It's terrible, right? Oh my God.
There's a lot of human players, top pros, I think, that would hesitate to play this move.
Yeah.
I think the player here, Lee Qincheng, was actually a bit unusual in that he actually played this move. So it's much better shape just to extend here.
Of course.
And the idea is that White is leaving this weak point.
Right.
So if Black answers that, then it's White doesn't need, like, if we assume White playing this mark point and Black playing this mark point, that stone at two is sort of it's a slow move. So White's gained a move to get a nice little position there with playing three on the side. So something like this might follow. This is actually much more playable for White. This is a better variation. I could go back and say that the moment Black played this pressing move in the lower left corner, it was already good for Black. So I'd say Black does have a good score, but this is going to be better for White than the game. And the point to this extension here is that if Black tries to attack with something like this, White can extend down here, and this is going to be a double threat with the cut here and the ladder here. So if Black plays here to stop White from capturing that cutting stone, White can cut here and extend. And the ladder in the center of the board, or sometimes it's a geta, either a ladder or a geta works. So if Black extends here, then White can capture the two stones. This would actually be very good for White, with the whole area, this whole area becoming a weak area for Black. So when White extends here, Black does have to protect on this side. That means White gets this opportunity to have a kind of a base there on the side. So this would be much better for White than the game. So when White extends, White plays the Atari, White has to return to the connection on the fourth line, and that's the difference there, because if White extends here and White gets to have much better shape. When White plays here, White doesn't have the option of playing a connection on the top, because White's shape here would be completely ruined when Black plays here. So it's that one move difference. And now Black is going to cut on the sixth line. Oh, actually, White got to protect there. So Black was threatening to cut here next. So White protects there. And we're going to see White having a lot of pain on the lower side here when Black plays this. You can see there's all these cuts that Black is aiming at. And at this point, the game is already like Black's more than 10 points ahead on the board before Komi.
Yeah.
But I'll just show you. It becomes a kind of a forcing sequence. So I'll show you how AlphaGo just sort of bulldozers to make a big moyo in the center of the board. And you can see, just looking at the flow of moves here, you can see how Black is not only taking a position in the center of the board, sort of controlling this whole area, Black is already also getting a nice position on the lower side. So it's like Black is playing all over the place. And just look at all these white stones that are doing nothing, basically. They're just connecting up. This wall of white stones that is surrounding 0 points of territory. And so this is another, you know, it's one of the top players in the world being forced to play dame points in the first moves of a game.
Right.
black is getting all this territory and all sorts of, it's like, you know, white is sort of standing still. And this happens so many times in these AlphaGo games.
No, I was just going to say, I mean, you can really see AlphaGo simply take control of the game. And that sequence from white makes one slack move, the Atari, which, as you say, is really just, you know, let's put it down to something you just did in a moment with a speed game or something. But, you know, and then AlphaGo just takes the game from there. Mm-hmm. I mean, everything after that must be responded to. There's no choice, right?
There was a lot of what happened here in the center of the board was pretty much a forced sequence.
Yeah. I mean, it just feels like this poor guy's being just pushed around the board, you know? Right. I mean,
yeah, if this was a boxing match, it would be pretty bloody, I'm sure.
Yeah, the referee would have to call. Oh, my goodness. Wow. Fascinating. I just seeing the way he just boom, 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 boom. Amazing. Okay. All right. All right. And this was just the one game he had, right?
Yes, he only played this one game.
I think I know why. Well, thank you so much, Michael. And thank you all for watching. We will, of course, look forward to Volume 2. This is AlphaGo versus the World, and this will be Volume 2 of AlphaGo 2-0. So see you next game.